We are now beginning, we finished the Maimer in Torah Or. We finished the Maimer in Torah Or, and it talks about how the process by means of which God perceives what's going on in the world, and how he also perceives our prayers, and how he reacts to what's going on in the world. And we explained that the first Rebbe of Chabad, and he explained it three ways. And the first we explained, said that there's what's called lights and vessels, and that the vessels, they sort of interact with the world, and the lights are more like the essence of God. And it's the two types of eyes of God, the feminine eyes that survey the world, Meshotatot, they receive what's going on, and masculine eyes, that's Meshotatim, that they, so to speak, react to what's going on. That was the first explanation. Then after that, the Rebbe gave a second explanation of two ways of perception of God. Kael Deos Hashem, Das Elyon v'Das Tachton, the upper perception and lower perception. The lower perception of God is that there's a world, and that the world exists, and God creates it, and that God cares about it, and God reacts to what's going on down here. He reacts to what's going on. That's the lower perception. And the upper perception, that's everything is revealed to God automatically. God created everything from the beginning. All time, all deeds, all actions, all interactions. God, everything is already known by God. It's known by God. For the first time, not only is it known, it's already created, so to speak, somehow or other. We don't understand what this means. We have no idea what it means. This is what's called, because that's called the upper awareness. It's not accessible to us. Then there's the lower awareness, where God interacts with the world, and that's more relevant to us. Then the Rebbe had a third one. He said that according to the Sefirot, the lower awareness of God, this lower level of God, the aspect of God that interacts, so to speak, with the world and that judges the world, that's from Malchut. That's from the lowest sphera. He explains according to the Sefirot, the 10th Sefirot of God, Malchut. And that, the upper awareness of God, that's already, so to speak, God's emotions or God's essence, something that's above this level of Malchut. And that's the source of all forgiveness and all kindness. The lowest aspect of God, the lower aspect, that's judgment. And the upper, that's kindness. And that's what God was saying about Sodom and Amorah. I will come down and I will see. And it was, I'll come down, I'll try to bring my aspect of kindness into the world. Maybe I can find some sort of an excuse for what's going on there, the terrible atrocities that are occurring in Sodom and Amorah. And so to speak, God came down, tried to bring down this aspect of kindness into the world, and he was not able to do it, but the sins were too bad, and therefore he had to destroy it. That's the three explanations that we learned. Why are we learning these explanations? Because we have to remember, it comes from a basic problem, a big problem we have, which is based on the truth that God is one, that God created the whole world from absolute nothing. And the world, it has no real true existence on its own, except that God is constantly, so to speak, bringing it into existence. And the only reason he's doing this the Rebbe didn't get into in this Maimer. Why is he doing that? Why is God bringing the world into existence all the time? Why? So the answer is that this should come, a person like Abraham, that should serve God, interested in serving God, a person that should realize that basically the whole world is a big miracle and that we're really nothing and that God is creating us every moment and that we're very, very important to God. What we do is very tremendously important. This world is tremendously important to God, to the degree that I would even say that before the world was created, God was alone. Adon Olam Asher Malach B'Terem Kol Etzer. He was alone. That wasn't really true existence. True, real, truly infinite existence begins when man serves God. That's when the whole business begins. That's when existence really begins. Because when people do what God wants, especially when the Jews do the commandments, That's above time. That reaches above this level of what's called the upper knowledge of God. And so that's God's essence already. And that's what Abraham realized. In other words, don't think about it. You know what you have to do. You have to think in order to realize what direction to take in life. But once you understand, and then your doing so depends on your attitude. You want to call it your heart. It depends on your heart. You have to have knowledge. You have to have understanding. You have to have wisdom. You have to have direction. You have to have purpose. You have to have the values. But after all, in order to actually do it in the world, to actually bring these values from the lecturing podium or from your philosophical books or whatever that you write, or religious books, right? In order to actually bring these principles into the world, to serve God and to be faithful to your values and your conscience every single instant, as this takes someone like Abraham, crazy. You have to be crazy. You have to be totally not normal. You have to not pay attention to what everybody's saying, because everyone in the world is compromised. Everyone. Everyone's compromised, including me. Maybe me first. I don't know. I don't know how. What about you guys? But everybody is compromised to a certain extent. Everybody has certain fears about the world. Everybody is affected by the world. And even those, and the worst ones are people like me that I know what I'm supposed to do. And a lot of times you just don't do it. You know, you're a little bit lazy, you're a little bit this, you know. Okay, I mean, we're not talking about severe sins, but on the other hand, the person who knows what he's supposed to do and he does it, it could be much, much worse than a person who doesn't really know what he's, or he doesn't believe in God at all, and he doesn't, and he does really terrible things. Who knows how, I don't know how God judges these things. But the point is, we're not supposed to think about that. When you know what's right, it takes courage. You have to be a hero in life, in your own personal life, not your hero, your pictures in the papers, that you have to be a hero in order to hold on to your values. And it could be that you're totally alone and nobody even knows about it. That's Abraham. Abraham was totally alone. Nobody knew about it. God knew about it. It's written in the Torah. Okay, let's go. We finished that. So let's learn a sikh of the Rebbe. I really wanted to learn another mimer, but I couldn't find one online, the one that I wanted. All right, here we go. So we're learning a sikh of the Rebbe. Aina from the Milas, Velcha Avram Avinu, is Suga coming. This is, by the way, this sikh of the Rebbe was spoken by the Rebbe. I hope this doesn't give me troubles here. This was spoken by the Rebbe, which year, I'll tell you. There it is, huh? Not one more page. Okay, we'll find out. It's something like 1954. Here it is. 1954. I was right. 1954. Tom was 1954. That's 1954. Okay, let's see how much of this we can finish. One of the excellent achievements or levels, Velcha Avram Avinu is Tugam, which Abraham reached during the mitzvah Mila through the commandment of circumcision, is as Dummel then, is er Gavorn Roy, he was fitting, he was able to Gebroyan Yitzchak, to give birth to Yitzchak. If you remember before, God said, Abraham said, I don't have any children, what am I going to do? And my wife is old. And God said, he took him outside and the stars. So I said, look at the stars. And Rashi brings down that God said, I'm taking you above the stars. He says, you Avram, his name, he hadn't circumcised. When Abraham circumcised himself, God changed his name also from Avram. So he said, Avram, that's your name before the circumcision, can't give birth to children, but Avraham can. Avraham can birth. Okay, the fact of the matter is that Avram did give birth to children. He gave birth to Yitzchak. Ishmael, sorry. He gave birth to Ishmael. 12 years before he was circumcised. And 1 year after he was circumcised, that's when he gave birth to Yitzchak. And God said, Yitzchak is going to be the main one. The Jewish people are going to come from Yitzchak, not from Ishmael. But Abraham did give birth. Okay, I'll just tell you one small thing. In fact, Abraham, this is a sikha from another place, from last week. When God told Abraham that he was going to have a son, he was going to change his name, he was going to have a son. So Abraham said, listen, I think Yishmael is good enough. Lu Yishmael yamod lefanecha. Yishmael should be your son. Yishmael is already my son. He'll be the continuer of the Jewish people. You don't have to make a big miracle, God. You know, you have to. So the Rebbe asked the question. When Avram said Yishmael should be, he was already 99 years old. He was 99 years old. And he saw what Yishmael was doing. Yishmael was okay. And Yishmael's mother, Hagar, was called Keturah, that all of her deeds, it says, were like in the Holy Temple, like the incense in the Holy Temple. And it says that his mother had left, she was the daughter of Paro. She left splendor in order to come and be just the handmaid of Avraham. And Avraham was, he had a good sense of judgment. He had been through a lot already. And like, true, it was before the circumcision, but nevertheless, he had been through a lot. So the Rebbe said, Avram was right. He was right. Up to then, he was really right. Yishmael could have been the progenitor, the continuer of the Jewish people. He could have been. According to any normal standards, he could have been. But God didn't want normal standards. God wanted to say that the Jewish people, it's forbidden. It's forbidden for them to be normal. If the Jewish people act normal, then you can finish Judaism. It's all finished. People are going to start to get logical. They're going to say, hey, this doesn't make any sense. You know, why should it be that only, that only a court, a judicial court has to be three men? Why women aren't intelligent also? Why three men, right? Could be the women also. What's the problem? All of a sudden, a person starts thinking, what's this big deal about, you know, Shabbat comes exactly at this time, that this food is kosher, this food is kosher. Eventually, a person starts using his mind a little bit, and he'll just throw away the whole Torah. You have to be a little bit crazy in order to do the Torah. And in fact, the whole essence, motivation, like we talked about before, is craziness. And that's the thing of Yitzchak. Yitzchak had two things that Yishmael did not have. Yitzchak, first of all, he was born unnaturally. Yishmael was born naturally. Abraham had relations with Hagar, and she gave birth to Yishmael. But Sarah, it says it was impossible for her to give birth. It's possible for 100. Avram at that time was, what does it say? 86 years old. He gave birth to Yishmael. So he gave birth to, it's 86 year old men can give birth. It's possible. It's not that big of a miracle. Especially if his wife is young. Here, Abraham was old, and also Sarah was old. And it says in another place that Sarah didn't even have, it was impossible for her to give birth to children naturally, even when she was young. It says Sarah Akara. It says when he married her in the end of the book, in the end of chapter of Noah. So Yitzchak was born through a miracle. His birth was through a miracle. And his circumcision was when he was 8 days old, not according to his desire, according to his understanding. Yishmael decided, he said, okay, I'll be circumcised together with my father, Yishmael. Whatever considerations he had, but there were certainly considerations that he had. And Yitzchak, though, was thrown into the circumcision automatically. He says, that's the essence of a Jew. Everything has to be normal, true, but the basic inner motivation for everything is a miracle, is above understanding. And that's why Yitzchak was this. Okay, so when Avram was circumcised, only then could he give birth to Yitzchak. According to this Maimon Rizal, that Yitzchak, Hagadarv Gaborn Varn, that Yitzchak had to be born from a Tipa Kadosha Davka, from a seed that was holy. And it was after Avram was circumcised. Like it says, Asher Kirish Yedid Mi Beten. It's one of the sentences we say after the circumcision. Asher Kirish Yedid Mi Beten B'chok B'Besor Yisrael says that he was talking about Yitzchak. It's a statement that we make in the ceremony, the circumcision, that Yitzchak was holy from his birth, from his conception. Therefore, Avram, chach oich var mitzvahs, even before the mitzvahs milah, he was a chariot for God. God told him, lech lecha, he told him. Aber es nednich gevorn roy, but even though Abraham was a holy person, he was 99 years old, but still he was not, and he had served God his whole life, he was not yet fit to have Yitzchak. Nor b'shas is tzu gechumen, only when he came to, v'hayet tamim, that he was whole, complete. How was Abraham complete? He removed his foreskin. Durach mila is demult, only then had gekent zayin Yitzchak geboren, only then could Yitzchak be born. From this, is oich verstand, it's understood, the mila from Yitzchak, the difference between Yitzchak, how Yitzchak is better than Avram. For whom? Because by Avram, geboren men nit as soll haben gedarft sein der munter tanai. Because Avram was born, went to Mirnit as soll haben gedarft sein der as Avram geboren men nit. Oh, Avram was not born from this condition that he had to come from a holy seed, right? The seed of his father didn't have to be holy. Avram's father was Terach, wasn't holy at all. But Yitzchak's gebor, Yitzchak was born, afilu noch alles friedeke milos, despite all of the tremendously high levels that Avram had achieved beforehand, but it wasn't sufficient. Hat das nitke kent sein, it couldn't be either before is angekommen zu hey tamim, before he was circumcised. Was is their tam for was? What's the reason why Yitzchak had to be born from a holy drop of semen? Why was Yitzchak had to be special from everybody else? The chilek from Avram, Yitzchak, the difference between Avram and Yitzchak is Avram's inyan is hamshacha milamay lamata. Avram, the whole thing of Abraham, it says that Avram, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, they correspond to the three aspects of God that they brought into the world. Avram's thing was kindness, love. Yitzchak's thing was gevura, like fire, from below to above. Yaakov, we'll talk about later, that's harmony, that's balance. We'll talk about that. Avram's thing is bringing godliness down from above to below. His thing was adding, putting godliness, putting good into the world. Yitzchak inyan is halam ilamata maila. Yitzchak thing is changing the world, elevating the world from below to above. Azoy vias vert, and they're clear, like it's explained, a few maimor chassidus and a lot of maimor chassidus, that the service from Avram is love like water, a liebshaft zum ebishter, verche is gegleichen zu Wasser, a love to God which is compared to water, azoy vi mirzok, like we say in the prayer of Gesser, and the prayer we pray for rain, and we just finished praying in last day of Sukkot. Zachor av nimshach achrecha, come on. Remember our forefather Avram that was drawn after you like water. This is just translation in Yiddish. So Avram's whole thing was love like water. Vet de teva from Vasser, the nature from water. Let's see if this is right. The nature from water is arup tzu nidrin from oyben arup, from coming down from above to below. The avoda from Yitzchak, that was Avram. The service of Yitzchak is ahava karish veish, loving God like fire. Yeah, flame fire, like a flame. Was the teva from fire, the nature of fire is tzitzich from unten arup, to go from above, below to above. The untershed, the difference between Avram and Yitzchak is given nitnor in their avoda, not only in the service with themselves alone. That Avram's thing was bringing down, was love, and Yitzchak was power, gevura, change, like fire. Nor oyech in zeravoda was zaman a rav katan in the veld. Also, how they related to the world. Avram had gepoiled is the veld in the world in ear that in the world zol nimshach veren get lechayt milamay lamata. They should draw godliness from above to below. Abraham, we'll see how. He built an inn, it says a free restaurant in the middle of the desert, a free hotel in the middle of the desert. We'll see. When Yitzchak had gepoiled in veld, and the Torah tells us that Yitzchak, what he did in the world is as zich alain zoldaheben veren, that everything should be, the world should be elevated. Veren a kli, so that it should be a vessel for godliness. Alam yilamata lamayla. Elevate. That's what it means. Elevating the world from below to above means making the world a vessel for godliness. When Adam Chiluk and that difference, Zetman Oich in the Ophanim from Zer Hanaga, we can see what they did in the world. Loit vid the Torah, that's all, like the Torah tells us. Avram Avinu had Mamshich given. Avram, he drew down godliness to everybody. In Eretz Canaan, in the land of Canaan. V.S. is Gavon Kodim, like it was V.Z. is Gavon Kodim Abirur. He was in the land of Canaan before it was refined at all. Even in Egypt, he says that Egypt, Avram went down to Egypt. Remember, there was nothing to eat. Everyone had to go down to Egypt. Bizvanen Er Hat Mamshech Gavon, because he drew down godliness even into the Arabs, the Bedouins, a robber. Velcher Flecht Zich Buken Zich, that used to bow down to the dirt, which is the from their foot to the dirt on their feet. So that's why they had to wash their feet, because they would bow down to the dirt on their feet. They worshiped the dirt on their feet. Why? It was actually very logical. A person, if he's stuck in the house, if he's sick, he can't go out. He can't go out into the world and make a living. That a person is able to go out and walk and get things done in the world. So this is a very amazing thing. So they would pray to the sun, to the moon, to this, and also to the dirt, and especially to the dirt on their feet. The dirt on their feet was an amazing blessing, that you could actually go out and get your feet dirty. You sit at home, your feet are clean, your shoes are clean. You know, they say that joke that a lazy person saves money on shoes, right? They never goes out, so he never wears his shoes up. So they were thanking the dirt on their feet that they could go. Was thus is a tamar nidruko. This, after all, you know, it could be logical, but this is a very low level. A mensch is angetelt in dry tile. A person is generally, you can categorize the different aspects of a person. You can divide a person. Head, this, one of them is head, body, and feet. Their foos, the feet from a person, is the nidruk, is the lowest level of the lowest limb. The shtoib, the dirt which is on the feet, is even lower than the feet themselves. These Arabs, these Bedouins or whatever, had zainen gishtanen in azoy nidruk madriga. They were such a low level, azay haben zich buken zich. They gebukt. They used to bow down to the dirt which is on their feet. This means that their whole mind, from their brain, was in the lowest level possible. I mean, instead of thanking God, which is above you, they would thank the dirt, which is totally below them. I mean, it's a good thing they were giving thanks to something that you know, certainly one good aspect of what they did. But on the other hand, just think about it. I mean, that's the thing you pray to the dirt on your feet. Nevertheless, from this vega, nevertheless, Avram Avinu, we're not coming to tell them how bad they were and how good Abraham was. No, exactly the opposite. As low as these people became, Avram Avinu, he realized that the reason they were that way was because they weren't educated. Nobody told them that there was anything better. At least, like I said, they were worshiping something. Nevertheless, Avram Avinu had zich upka given. He devoted himself. And he drew to them godliness also in them. Like the rabbis say, or if the pasuk says, "By Yikra Hashem b'Shem Hashem Kel Olam," that Abraham called over there. He says he made an eshel be'er sheva. We'll see in the end of this week's Torah portion that he made like this free hotel in a place called Be'er Sheva in the middle of the desert. And he called over there. It says Vayikra. He called over there the name of God, God World. Al tikra Vayikra. Don't say that he just called. Ela Vayakri. He made other people. Das er hat gemacht ois rufen. He caused other people to call out. Er hat gepoilt by others. Zay zal shrayan kel olam, that God is the God World. Explains other places that what does it mean, God world? It should be the God of the world, the king. We say every day, the Melech Ha'olam. It says Abraham's, it doesn't really explain in the Torah. Very interesting. It doesn't really explain in the Torah what exactly was Abraham's point. What really was his message? What was firing him up? You know, God spoke to him and told him these weird things, you know, circumcise yourself, kill your son. You know, go to Israel, you're going to be rich, you're going to be there. And he got there and there was nothing even to eat. He lost everything, right? And then he had to go to Egypt and then his wife was taken prisoner. What's the point of all these stories, you know? I mean, it's sort of interesting, but what is it telling us? So Chassidut Chabad explains it, that this is one of the things, Kael Olam, that Avram Avinu, he realized that God and the world are not two things, that the world itself is just this big miracle that God is creating all the time. Every second from nothing, the world depends totally on God for its very existence. And that's what he told even these low Arabs. Yesterday they were worshiping the dirt on their feet, and now suddenly they were calling out the king of the universe. Thank you. How did he do it? He said, I'll give you free food, anything you want free. Just say, thank you, the king of the universe that creates everything. Thank you. And the Arabs say, sure, I'll say it. What's the problem? And everyone was saying this. Avram spent a fortune, just so that people would call out the name of God. People would at least direct their attention that there is such a thing. Azoivi, their Indian, just like Avram's service was drawing down godliness in the world, also is vegan, the kid making kalim, the vessels, in a way from drawing down. Azoivi is very declared, like it says in Rizal, is that often the way that Avram Avinu made everybody call godliness is that he used to take in guests. He took in guests in the middle of the desert and he gave them everything they wanted. And afterwards, when they were about to thank him, they thanked him. As Zadar Gazakti said, don't thank me, thank the one who gave you all this food. Thank the creator of the universe, the one who's creating the whole world. And that's what made Abraham, that was Abraham's trick to get everybody to call, like a Chabad house, to call godliness. Being a nice guy, Abraham was super nice. Yitzchak saying, but Yitzchak, the reason we're talking about Yitzchak is Yitzchak is born in this week's Torah portion. Yitzchak saying is given, like we said, raising up from below to above. Therefore, at our nit, he did not gehad ein getan kein sheikhs to Mitzrayim. He didn't have any connection to Egypt. He wasn't in Egypt. All of Yitzchak's life was in Israel. He never went outside of Israel. That's what Yitzchak says. He was an ola tamima. He was a pure sacrifice. Val er is given an olatami. Oh, there he said, it was a pure sacrifice. When oich zainen in Eretz Israel, and when he was in Israel, hoter gahat sutan mit chafiras beros. What did he do? He dug wells. That's what the Torah tells us. That he dug a well here and he dug a well there and he dug a well there. We'll learn about this next week. What do you mean digging wells? What is digging wells? Digging wells means you go to a place where there's a desert and nobody can live there. It's impossible to live there, right? You have to bring your own water and you can't stay there very long. And he would dig a well. As soon as there's a well, means that there was irrigation and that people would have water to drink. They didn't have to go anywhere else. And also you could irrigate the land and things would grow. As soon as things started growing, as farmers would come and they would settle. And then somebody has to provide them with meat, right? So there would come people with flocks and you would make a whole big city just because you had water. That's what Yitzchak did. He elevated the world. He revealed godliness from below to above. On plek and get lechait durch darheben the uns, by elevating us. Same thing the world. The world is a big desert. There's no godliness. As soon as you reveal godliness, then the world is a livable place. Talmadrigas Yitzchak is given up getrugan from veld, because Yitzchak was removed from the world, elevating from below to above. Azoy v era line, just like he himself was the level of Yitzchak, was going from below to above, as also the same thing he had done to the world. He elevated the world, made the world into a vessel to godliness, instead of just being a dead world with no meaning in it. Be the Torah that said, like the Torah tells us, that Yitzchak's service was digging wells, as Groban the Brunims, that's the digging the wells. Thus, made this means Anplekin and Aroif Tzutzian, that he revealed and he drew the living water, which is under the ground. Nit Aroin Arain Gisan Ahin, I am not pouring water from another place, but only to reveal the water, the wells, which are already there. Varum, because they're emes, because the truth is, as dort kefin in zich mayim chayim, because he knew that living water was found in this place, so he dug. Mernit was fathered mit eret. It's just that he has to deal with the ground, blotta, mud, unsteiner, and stones. Unbeshas men nemta rup. As soon as you remove what's concealing this living water, is then you can reveal all of a sudden there's living, there's a well, there's living water. You can live, you can make a city there. Was thus vased oich an oif zain ruchnis tikar avodah. This also shows on the spiritual service of Yitzchak. Not that this, he was a city planner or something. No, a rov kenemet de ala zachen, that Yitzchak's thing was to remove anything that conceals und verstelt and prevents the revelation of godliness. On machen the veld, making the whole entire world a vessel for Hashem. Hala milamata lamaylav, revealing from below to above. Vidamayim chayim, like the water alone, living water. Velchazayin and novea, which is there, so we can just reveal it. But like you get your computer fixed, as soon as you get your computer fixed, then it can receive all these messages and things like that. That's what Yitzchak's thing was, to fix up the world. Nit nor, in order that it could to reveal godliness. Not only Yitzchak had zich nit gerechen, he didn't reckon with the kegenzatz and with kegenstan, with the opposition velcher decken, which concealed over this living water. But even more, he had not reckoned with any sort of opposition velcher stern, which tried to prevent his digging the wells. The Torah that said, like the Torah tells us, that the time when he tried to kokumen, Avimelech came, faster echer, Avimelech, he was the king, his like servants came, and they tried to drive away Yitzchak's, when Avimelech's men came, and they tried to drive away Yitzchak's men, stopped the Bronim, and they tried to close up the wells, Yitzchak was not affected by it at all. And he just dug another well. Even more, Afilu, even when, says Tzuganumen, the Bronims, even when Avimelech, he was the king, Avimelech, he took away the wells, which the servants of Yitzchak dug, and they gave the wells to the Palestinians, as this means that In a deeper sense, that let's take the example here. We're talking the well water. That's godliness, and that's Yitzchak's thing, is revealing godliness. What says that Yitzchak's enemies, they stuffed up the wells, and not only that, they drove away Yitzchak and his men, and they tried and they gave the wells away to the Palestinians. Says this means as giving away the varmkeit un zu welchem and hat sich that they took away, that the world takes away the warmness and the enthusiasm that you have for godliness. That's this living water, as Nemt Menorayin in Kalipa, that it's given, even if it's given to the Palestinian, to the world, the person starts getting interested in the world and getting all hot about the world. as Oich Demel, even then, Yitzchak was not affected whatsoever. Umbashas men had sugenumen. Oich the Tzveitabron, whenever they took the second well, Hater Gabrach, so he just dug a third well. This is to come in until he came to the well, which is called Rehovot, which is wideness. And then God said he gave him back the first wells that he had before. Al Pisechel, according to logic, is nit given kain or there's no place in logic to not be scared of Avimelech. In that time, this Avimelech that opposed Yitzchak, he was the king, and he was the king of the whole land, and he said, "Hey, you can't dig wells here. This is my land. I'm the king of the whole place. I have all these men. I can kill you in an instant. Don't dig wells." And he was opposed to holiness, and the wells which had been dug as Avimelech, he took them to himself. Yitzchak did not make any sort of calculations. He wasn't interested in figuring out what was worthwhile or not. He knew one thing. His idea is that he revealed living water. That's his job. That's his job in the world. The service, therefore, he didn't pay any attention to Avimelech at all. Same thing, a Jew shouldn't pay any attention to all the opposition that he has in the world to do good. The service to make from the world a vessel to godliness, this touches the true infiniteness of God, the Ein Sof Baruch Hu, because this is why God made the world, that we should do it, because through that, you can actually do the whole purpose of intention. Like it says that God wants to make the world into a godly place. That's why Yitzchak is called by the name of Yitzchak. Yitzchak means tzchok. Tzchok means joy, happiness. This is what makes the world a happy place. When you reveal godliness in the world, then it becomes a good world. Tzchok. And this is the when you remove all the things that conceal godliness, all the things which are nature. Nature is the gematria. That's the name Elohim that creates nature. As we just have to remove that, and Yitzchak, when he removes that, that's called making happiness, pleasure in the world. According to this, now we can understand why Yitzchak had to be born from a holy drop, from a holy a seed, because Avram's level alone is tremendous, from Atzilus, from this highest level of godliness, Elokus Bagbala, but it was still limited. And during when Abraham was circumcised, then he became to what's called a completeness, as Hayat Tamim, he was complete, which this is the whole idea of godliness, which is above the world of Atzilut. It's above any levels. Undas het arois gerufen by Yitzchak, and this is what aroused in Yitzchak this service, which is also unlimited. He didn't pay any attention to any opposition. Not even from logical holiness. I mean, if Avimelech would have killed Yitzchak, so then it would have finished the whole Torah. There wouldn't be any Torah. It's just for a few wells. What's the point? And Yitzchak knew, no, I have to dig these wells, and the wells have to be on the side of holiness. And therefore, he didn't pay attention. What can we learn from this? Avram and Yitzchak, they are both called the fathers of Judaism. By every single Jew, there has to be these two services of God. First of all, the service of Avram and the service of Yitzchak. When a Jew deals with the Torah, prayer, and doing the commandments, as sometimes he finds, Gefinz erzich, doch in lichtika dalet amos, then he's in a holy place. Erad nitzutan, he doesn't have anything to do with the world. He sits in the synagogue or wherever, and he sits and he learns, he sits in the yeshiva. Nidnor ven farnemt zich, with the Tzvei Kavim from Torah and Avoda, not only when he's learning Torah and he's praying, but even when he farnemt zich mitn kav from Gemilas HaSadim, even when he's doing good deeds and he's doing the commandments, Nevertheless, he's separated from the world. Voser darf tan mit gashmis tikazachen. He's dealing with the physical commandments. Is there aber fundeswegen? Nevertheless, he is. Demolt farnumen mit mekayim dein rotzon. He's doing what God wants in the world. He's got no opposition. That's Abraham. Holiness. Mer nit vos er is mamshich. The Ebrister is just drawing down godliness, making all sorts of blessings. Aber erad nit zutan mit gashmis, but he's not really doing with the physical world. He doesn't have to go out and make a living. Un kol shekhen, much more so, nit mit kain menagid. He hasn't got any opposition. Un afilu mit the epis vos fardekt un farstelt. He hasn't got anything which opposes or conceals godliness. That's Abraham. Un afilu men hat azoy darga. Even when a person had reached this level of Abraham, the first Jew, pure Jew, darv men vezin, you have to know, as does is nit, not this, not this is not the purpose from serving God. Just to be a holy Jew and to do Torah, to learn command, to do the commandments, to do good deeds, that's wonderful. But that's not, that's only the beginning. Thus is blois avoda from Avram. This is like the service of Avram. But now you have to have the service of Yitzchak. Mendarv haben sutan, you have to also deal with the world. Mit the world. And these people was droisen sich, zet sich oiv ze, and the people which try to oppose you, you have to when ze nit nit mer verstein steinen und blotter. He says there could be all sorts of stones and dirt that cover over godliness in the physical world. Says you, that's what you have to dig to in order to find the real living water. The real living water is, you have to have Torah, you have to have the commandments, you have to, but the real living water is found in the world. What does that mean? In the world, there can be dirt covering over yourself. A person can learn Torah, do mitzvahs, and have a terrible personality. You have to dig into yourself, and you also have to, and there can be also opposition. You want to reveal godliness in the world. There's going to be opposition. Das heißt, mit unser mit azoyna, with such people, which they are ois erlich farzunken in isurim, people that like to do sins, they like the dirt, they like the mud, they want to do sins, and they want to have nothing to do with you or with Judaism. Even with those people, you also have to deal with and also to dig and find in them also the living water. A rup genemen from Zay, you have to remove from them also all the things which conceal the godliness and reveal the living water, which is covered up in them as well. Kenman, a person can say, er hat schoen geprovert grubben einmal. You can say, listen, I already tried with this person to reveal godliness. I tried. And I try it again. Un nit nor was er zet nit kan, and I don't see any benefit, but exactly the opposite. The police team, they're taking away, right? The Avimelech, he's taking away all the work that I did for himself. Is was far an ort? Why should I try again and try convincing people that there's godliness and there's Judaism is good and be a Jew, act like a Jew? We're talking about Jews. We're not talking about things. Trying to convert people, talking about just revealing the Judaism in a Jew. You say, listen, I tried once, I tried 10 times, and it just doesn't get anywhere. I just, or if them, we have to say, Asher Kadesh did me better. But say, it's of, holy, that the service of Yitzchak is, and the children of Yitzchak, unzain kinder, and his children, the children of Yitzchak, has to be without making all these calculations. I did it so many times and it didn't work. Das was bis itzt hat nit matzliach, given that which he didn't succeed. Thus is their Eibishter's cheshbonus. This is God's business. You have to do the deeds. The results, that's not up to you. The results are up to God. You know what you have to do. And isn't that the basis of all Judaism? Here we've been hoping for Mashiach, hoping the base of Migdash is going to come, gather up all the Jews. We've been waiting at least 2,000 years since the destruction of the temple, really even more. And we don't see anything going. So a normal person will say, hey, what's the point of these Torah and commandments? I mean, we're trying so hard and nothing really comes of it. Let's try something else. That's only logical. It says it's true, it's logical. And that's the opposite of Judaism, to be logical. In such cases, you have to be like Yitzchak to do what God wants without making any sort of calculations. Like it says, in those mysteries of God, don't deal with it. It's not your business. Voses nogea tzu'im, what's relevant to me is, as er mus groben, you have to just dig and dig. Biz er vet zich dar groben, until you finally, for sure, will reach the living water. Godliness is in everything. The world is basically good. Und sof sof, in the end, better to come, and you can come to Erchiv Hashem, Uprina Boretz, and finally come to a great, how do you say, success and joy and being fruitful and seeing tremendous results from this work that we're doing in exile in the future redemption with Mashiach Tzikenu now. Okay, now let's learn the Devar Malchut. We're almost finished with this Devar Malchut. We started Devar Malchut. Let's see if we can. Oh, here it is.